Top Fade.
Good evening and welcome to episode 14 of the Lock-In Pub Quiz. And today it is the non-celeb special. Every week I condescendingly tell our viewers to play along at home in a tone which week in, week out, I imagine, starts to come across as pretty damn aloof. Play along at home, the host chortles, but you shall never grace the hallowed turf of the video conference. Well, this week the tables have turned, and may I say, what a relief. No more kowtowing to the various media personalities, hacking through the jungle of their PR strategies, spinning plates as I try to keep a quiz going through a barrage of industry anecdotes. No, thank you, not this week. And before anyone starts anything in the comments, I'm well aware that many of our previous guests, and indeed I myself, barely count as celebrities, but that's the hook of this episode, and it's a lovely hook. Also, before anyone else starts anything, I'm not going out without the usual jacket because of the non-celeb special. It's because we are recording this on the hottest day of all of time. So, without any further ado, let's meet the three power legends who will be keeping it real this week. I will, in true quiz show fashion, be introducing you by your four names and hometowns. First up, we have Ed from Oxford. Hello, Ed.
Hi, Ivo. How are you doing?
Have you enjoyed any episodes of the Lock-In Pub Quiz that you've caught so far, if indeed you have at all?
Yes, I have. Though I was on from the very beginning. I think I used some of your questions for my own quiz as well.
Oh, steady on there. I'm not sure how I feel about that, A, from a copyright perspective, but also because many of the questions that we've used on this quiz have backfired spectacularly during the quiz itself. So presumably you've sort of been a bit more vigilant than we were troubleshooting some of the more debatable ones.
Well, I had someone try and claim that Wales was a country with one syllable.
Yeah. We had a lot of that rubbish in the comments, and I'm pleased to see that there are a lot of thumbs down for that particular commenter. It's part of the UK at time of writing. Do you enjoy hosting a quiz, Ed?
I have done. I've done like two, and they've been both a lot of fun. They've gone down pretty well.
Are there any tips you would give for me as I enter my 14th episode of hosting the Lock-In Pub Quiz?
Oh my God, I've not done 14, so I've...
I didn't bring out that number just to sort of put you down while I was...
No, but like, I feel that you've probably got more experience than I have.
You're absolutely right, Ed. There's nothing you can give me. Let's crack straight on, please, to Amy from Manchester. Sorry to shut you out there, but you're right. And also, I don't think it's Amy from Manchester. I think I was meant to go to Pippa from Swansea next. I'm falling apart. But let's do Amy from Manchester. Who cares? Yay. Sorry, Pippa. Amy, you've been bumped up the order to second introduction. I believe it is largely a pretty random science. How are you doing?
Yeah, good. That's never happened to me before. So,
what, bumped up from third to second?
Yeah.
What an absolute honour. I'm really pleased you're as delighted about it as you should be. Are you enjoying
Thanks,
this?
Ivo.
Absolutely vile heat wave at the moment?
No, I feel like I've been trying to avoid spontaneously combusting all day, pretty much.
Yes, well, I'm afraid to say the pub quiz has several rounds which may do that of their own accord. Have you managed to catch any previous episodes?
No.
Refreshing honesty. Say no more. It's not compulsory viewing. Not a sycophant like Ed.
I knew I was going to end up on as a guest one day, so I thought I'd keep it as a big surprise.
That's a really nice way to frame it, actually. Well, I'm very pleased that sort of medium-length held ambition has borne fruit over at episode 14. Pippa from Swansea, are you more of the I watch this every week and I nick the questions vibe, or more of the I literally don't know where I am vibe?
I would say somewhere in the middle most of the time.
Very diplomatic stuff. Are you in Swansea as we speak?
I am in Abertawe, indeed.
I'm afraid to say my Swansea geography is not good enough to know whether that is a glamorous part of Swansea or a nightmare part of Swansea.
That's the whole of Swansea.
I certainly wouldn't be making any comments to that end. Thank you very much. I've had a couple of lovely gigs at the Swansea Grand and I was very grateful for them. I've also had some absolute shockers. Shall we crack on with round one general knowledge, everybody?
Yes.
Well, that's great news. Have your pens and your paper at the ready. Obviously, Ed, have your second pen and paper to note down which questions you think might be good for your own quiz at a later date.
And a star system.
yeah, that's exactly how it is. And before we start, needless to say, in this age of content, if you could like the video and indeed even subscribe, to the Lock-In Pub Quiz, you'd be doing all of us a really huge favour. And if you're watching, of course, please play along at home, because we might be parachuting you into a future episode during, hopefully, a slightly less hot day. Question one in our general knowledge round is about Top of the Pops. When was the last episode of it broadcast? In what year? How confident are you feeling with that, Ed?
Not especially.
Pippa?
Not at all either. Rough estimate?
Yep, I think a rough estimate is all we can really hope for at this point. Well, here's one of a slightly different nature. It's also to do with history, but slightly further back. It's Henry VIII, a veteran of the Lock-In Pub Quiz and quizzes in general. Which two of his wives, of course he had six, were executed? He executed a third of his wives, but which two? Ideally, we'd like first name and surname, because this is just for 1 point. So it'll be half a point for each executionee. And if you only get their first name, or indeed only their second name, then we'll be into quarter points, which would be disgusting at this early stage. What is the only bird that can swim but not fly? What tickled you there, Pippa?
It's so wrong.
The answer you've given.
Yeah.
Right, that's fantastic. Let's crack through the next two so that we can get as quickly as possible to Pippa's wrong answer. It's very rare that you have someone telegraphing the hilarity of their own ignorance midway through a round, and it's great. Question four. Quick swig for Amy. Don't mind if she does. It looks complacent halfway through round one, but I suppose when your opponents are literally laughing at how bad their own answers are, you can't stop getting smashed. Question four. What musical instrument is also the French word for paperclip? In further disregard for the quiz, Amy's fanning herself with her own answer sheet.
Just drawn a paperclip as a reminder, because I don't think I can get that one.
Very effective solution. I'm not sure I would. This is going to sound absolutely crazy, but I wouldn't be confident to draw a paperclip, I don't think.
Well, I'll do it on the other side, because
I'd, Can you do a really big one, please? I'd love to see it. I'm thinking a.
Oh, it's not very big.
An oval with a smaller oval in it. Okay.
Just got that. Oh, it's like It's like the one that helps you on Microsoft Word and stuff.
I'm more than aware of what a paperclip is. It's just I've never actually got into the drawing a paperclip mindset. You know, it's
I've just gone with like the cartoon version of one.
Well, let's not get distracted by this lovely art project.
Yeah, it's took my mind off it now.
Yes, sorry. Well, I'll give you the question again. What musical instrument is also the French word for paperclip? I mean, what we're really just looking for is a French sounding musical instrument. Don't let me tell you how to do your jobs. Question five, and it's the five-point question that really skews round one. What are the colours of the five rings on the Olympic flag? We'd have expected to see a few Olympic flags waved around this summer, but it wasn't to be, but we should still be looking at them every day and revising the colours of the rings in preparation for next year. Amy, do you think the Olympics will happen next year, or do you think it will get sacked off again?
I think it'll be 2022 at least, mate.
You think they would postpone it to 2022? Surely if it doesn't happen next year, it's done.
I'm not that bothered about the sports, especially the Olympics. I prefer the Winter Olympics, actually. And I just think one of the big things with the Olympics is the big crowd thing. Like, people who aren't really that into sports will watch the Olympics, even if, you know, just for that kind of camaraderie feeling. People love going, and it's all the big touristy, you know, Skrilla making experience, isn't it? So I can't
Does
imagine.
Does Skrilla mean money there?
Yeah, I think it means the money in the films. Yeah,
absolutely love finding out a new word for money. I will be absorbing that into my personal life, and also just great to see your cynicism sort of go one level up from. The people who watch the Olympics because they're not into sport, but they get into it anyway. And then one level up, it's the people who know about those people, but still aren't getting into it. Ed, are you ready for the answers to round one?
Yeah.
Pippa, are you ready for the answers to round one?
Yes.
Here they come. Question one, Top of the Pops was last broadcast in 2006.
Ooh.
Celebrations in Swansea, another drink in Manchester, and a new pen in Oxford.
Red pen.
Gamut. Oh, the red pen for incorrect answers. That's heartbreaking stuff. Our second question was, which two of Henry VIII's wives did he execute? And the answers were Anne Boleyn, surely, and the slightly nicher of the two executionees, Catherine Howard.
And their cousins.
What?
Ooh.
Their cousins. Catherine Howard was Anne Boleyn's cousin, I believe. I believe they were cousins.
Checks out.
It doesn't check out. That's great. So
I believe, don't shoot me if that's wrong.
Proposed by Pippa and it's been seconded by Amy and Ed's shown no objection. So a final confirmation there that if you've got both cousins, Anne Boleyn and Catherine Howard, then you've got a point. And if you've only got one of them, you've got half a point. The bird that can swim but not fly is a penguin. But Pippa, what was your lolsome answer?
A chicken.
Chicken.
I redrew a picture.
But right. I feel you've slightly muscled in on the old drawing a paperclip turf there with your chicken. But did you think it was right?
Yeah.
Or did you just
I just went very blank, so I was like, I'll just pick a chicken.
Just pick a chicken and crack on. Well, that's what we call a lock-in pub quiz moment. And it's great to have our first one so early. Question four, French word for paperclip, also a musical instrument. Ed, I'll let you have a guess at this one.
I've put harp, but I'm not confident on that.
I'm afraid to say you're right not to be confident. You would be confident if you'd written trombone.
Yes.
Did Amy get that?
I got it. The drawing helped as well.
Yeah, I bet it did.
Because it looks like
a trombone.
Oh, I didn't even clock that, even looking at the drawing. And Pippa is intrigued that Amy's got that. Why? Because you
that's an impressive bit of knowledge. I liked it.
Right. Well, is it a compliment or is it a bit of beef? We will see. Go on. Amy, we're all really surprised that you've got that, actually. Really, really great stuff, actually. Question five. And we will be impressed if anyone's got all five of these. The five colours of the five rings on the Olympic flag. Those are, let's start with the primaries, blue, red, yellow, and then you've got green, and then you've got everyone's favourite absence of colour, black. Five for Amy?
Yeah.
Really fantastic stuff, well done. And Pippa? Also five, and Ed?
Yes.
I'm not into sports, but I'm into the library of sports.
What a great way to describe yourself. I hope that's on some sort of online dating profile bio.
No, I got with my wife before those existed.
Oh, I do apologise. Congratulations on your old
school. Got one in the bag
romance.
Now.
Nonetheless, if things do go awry for whatever reason and you do hit up the apps, mm-hmm. that thing about the library of sports is just great stuff.
Thank you.
So guys, that was a 9-point round. How many have we all got? Quite high scoring, I believe. Amy?
8.
Ed?
6.5.
Pippa?
7.
It is a tight spread, but Amy is very much the one to beat after round one. Round two, we've had a couple of times on this quiz, and it's always fun if visually confusing, but then that is the point. It is the missing landmarks round. We will look at five photos, which I dare say would make a lot more sense if they had the landmark, which has been artificially removed via Photoshop. Here's the first one by way of example, but also for a point, because it's the first one. So what should we be seeing in that photo? I'd say that's medium strength difficulty. Let's crack on to number two. What should we be seeing in this picture? Bloody hell. Question three concerns this lack of landmark. Well, I mean, now come on. It's a field. What on earth are you meant to do with that? But then when the answer comes in, that field might start to feel a lot more familiar. Beautiful days in all of these photos. Question four. What's been taken out of this? I am speeding through this round. Let's move on to the fifth and final picture, which is this.
Yikes.
What should we be seeing in this photo?
Are they Portaloos?
It does have a bit of a Portaloo vibe there.
Nice facilities.
Absolutely great. So that's a clue. It's a landmark which doesn't come with its own dogs. They've had to be tacked on. It's a great shame that the photoshopper couldn't have taken out the Portaloos as well.
Can't think.
Ed, what's your favourite landmark in Oxford?
The Pitt Rivers Museum.
That's inside with the dragon heads.
Yeah, that's one of my favourite things to go and see and be spooked out by every time.
Pippa, same question to you about Swansea Landmark.
Wow. So many to pick from. Don't actually know it that well, if I'm completely honest. I've only lived here 2 years, so...
Get stuck into the landmarks. Be a local tourist like Ed, going to look at the shrunken heads every week.
How about just Wine Street? Wine Street's a great asset to the city.
What sort of thing can one expect to find on Wine Street?
Wine Street's basically the piss-up central of Swansea.
I suspected as much, but I didn't want to say it again. That's for you.
It's a great spectacle at 1 a.m. on a weekend night.
Amy, very quickly, something nice in Manchester, if you would.
Hugh March, if you know that.
I don't.
Big stupid arch over Princess Parkway that looks quite fun, and it's a good kind of landmark for taxi drivers.
A good landmark for taxi drivers is a recommendation to stir the soul. And I dare say a few taxi drivers would know their way to these five landmarks. Here's your first one. If you could just drive me to the Sydney Opera House, please, that would be great.
God damn it.
I was too obsessed
with arches that I put that arch that's in St. Louis.
Oh no, I'm very sorry.
Arches on the brain.
Arches on the brain. Onto McDonald's, perhaps. not all of my quips make the edit, but if that one doesn't, there will be words. Question two. Pop yourself in a taxi and drive yourself all the way to the Taj Mahal.
Oh. I put Princess Diana, but put it in brackets, lol answer, so you knew that was a joke.
I think we'll give a point for Princess Diana, actually.
Oh, no, I put that as well as Taj Mahal.
Oh, really?
Goodness, yeah, I'm getting into the spirit of it now. You know the famous picture that everyone loves?
I understand, but I still think it might come across as a form of bet spreading to put two answers, even if one is notionally your joke answer.
Look, I wrote lol answer.
Okay, right. There it is. The rule is in place. You can write lol answers, but they have to say lol answer next to them. Otherwise, they will invalidate the non-lol answer. We come to a field now, which, if I'm not mistaken, is just off the A303. And if you were driving past this field, you'd probably be looking out of your car window and going, there's Stonehenge.
You're probably saying, that's really small.
Yes, you'd be saying that it was smaller than you expected it to be, or I didn't know that was a real thing, or do people actually go there in, you know, the summer solstice, and all the other classic Stonehenge.
Or is that it?
Is that it? Yeah. All right, Pippa, we've got that you don't really like the cut of Stonehenge's gym.
No, I spent a lot of my childhood there, that's why.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Did you ever go?
My parents would... Wouldn't it? Because we used to drive down to Cornwall, so it was always we'd come back that way, and then they'd point it out, and they'd be like, yeah, what do you do?
Whoop-dee-doo. Well, of course, also, Stonehenge is usually the point at which you realise that cutting diagonally via the A303 is usually slower than taking the M5 and M4. Pythagoras would not have had any success with his theorem if he'd driven back from Cornwall to London on a bank holiday Monday. Very specific knowledge there from Wiltshire, where I'm based, and we crack on now to an area I've got less trivia about, San Francisco, where, of course, you'd expect to find the Golden Gate Bridge. That is, I mean, of all the photos you could have got of the Golden Gate Bridge, that is hard. Barely a glimpse of San Francisco in the background. You're just looking at a lake. But on we go. And question five, it's everyone's favourite place to have a wee in a portaloo. It is, of course, the portaloo-adjacent Colosseum.
Oh.
There are little houses in the background. So where did they come from?
The photoshopper, this talented photoshopper, has removed the Colosseum and then popped in the houses that would have been behind the Colosseum.
I thought it would be the Leaning Tower.
No.
No, then there'd be all those people doing that by it, wouldn't there?
That would be such a great quiz question if you were able to work it out from the, I'm going to say it, twats. Or leaning away. And of course I did it when I went to Pisa, but I was young. So what have we all got out of five for that round? People weren't sounding quite as triumphant. We'll start with the leader, Amy.
Just two that time.
I'm sorry to hear that, but it might be good for the quiz. Ed, have you made up any ground on her?
Just two as well, so no.
You've maintained exactly the same distance from her. And Pippa.
I could lie, but I won't. Two again.
Two again. We barely
that was brutal.
Need have bothered with the round. The scores are exactly as far apart from each other as they are after round one. So let's see if we can split people up a bit more on round three, which is what we started to call the plagiarism round, which I think is not going to help avoid a lawsuit if one should come, but where we basically do a round from a TV quiz show. This week, it's catchphrase. You're going to watch some short videos and contestants are asked to say what they see in order to identify the correct catchphrase. And you've got to do the same, please, if you'd be so kind. So here is your first clip from Catchphrase. I think just the one opening of the bread would have sufficed there, rather than the correctly flirtatious, coquettish opening, reclosing, and opening and reclosing again. So that was your first phrase represented pictorially in the style of TV show Catchphrase. Here is your second phrase represented pictorially.
Oh,
God. Here we go again, zooming back and forth on that cap there on top of that flat, just in case there was any doubt about what we were meant to be looking at. it just goes to show that the 90s, it wasn't all great. Question three, here is your third weirdly aggressive video clue.
Am I awake?
I can't believe, I'll be honest, I never watched Catchphrase back in the day. I can't believe that this it was. Anyway, lovely picture of a penguin on the wall there for no real reason at all.
Reference to round one.
Reference to round one. This quiz is deeper than ever I could possibly have guessed. Question four. What's this clip? I've gone full circle and I'm now really enjoying these clips with their identical soul-sapping music. Now it is our final, with a heavy heart, it is our final catchphrase clip. I actually didn't get that one, and I've looked at the answer, and I'm not
That's
really...
That's the only one I did get, I think.
The only one you got?
Wow.
That can't be...
I even put my hipster glasses on for it.
Obviously, you're absolutely welcome to pop hipster glasses on at any point, but no glasses are that hipster that you couldn't have got... Oh, let's go straight to the answers. Number one, gingerbread, ginger spice appearing into yep. bread. Did you seriously not get it? No. Sorry, I realized it's more the fact that you did get number five. Number two, of course, we looked at a picture of a cat repeatedly bobbing up and down on a flat. And I then said, we're looking at a cat bobbing up and down on a flat. And Pippa, that didn't lead you at any point to write flat cap on your piece of paper? Question three. It did start to get a tiny bit harder at this point, maybe, as we looked at a top in bed with a tail, themselves in the top and tail formation. But that wasn't really doing much for you either, Pippa? No. She is writing herself out of the pub quiz at this point. But it's all going to be worth it when she plucks the correct answer for number five. Number four, Ed?
It's leader of the cards. No, of course, joking.
Well, actually, well, hang on here, because what I've got is ahead of the game. But
what?
It's also a leader of the pack.
Can I get a point for leader of the pack?
No, it was a board game.
I've got leader of the pack too. No, what was the pack of cards?
Right.
No, it had dice and...
I was on the verge... I was on the verge of handing out a point for Ed because of Leader of the Pack was so good, and also because I'd really enjoyed his Leader of the Cards, oh no, it's Leader of the Pack, sort of rug pull. But Amy has stepped in with some very good logic there.
Like a chessboard around it.
Oh, yeah.
I put front runner, which is funny because Ed could have been the front runner if I hadn't been such a petulant shit.
So without any further ado, we've got to the bit we're all looking for, where Pippa, who has basically gone for her
team
in the last four, has apparently got the right one for number five. What did you put?
Dress code.
That's exactly what you put. But I even picturing the image, I saw a sort of little coding machine. What was the thing next to it?
Well, there were signs on the fireplace saying black tie and smart only. And she was a fancy dress.
I didn't look at the surrounding clues. Ed, did you get that?
No, I put Morse code dress.
No!
I was so close.
Say what you see.
That all of the ingredients and then some bonus ingredients.
I put fashion SOS.
Fashion SOS. So, Pippa, we know you got one for that round, yeah. But how did the people who were actually trying for questions one to four do? Ed?
I got three.
Three. And Amy?
I got three, too.
Amy, 13, Ed, 11.5, Oosh. Pippa, 10. It's still very close. And the next round is round four, which carries us over the commercial break, is, as always, a one-question, 10-pointer. You've just got to name all the things in this category. And the category is movies again, just like last time. And it's Jim Carrey movies from the 90s. What 10 movies did Jim Carrey star in the 90s? No lol answers, please. Just 10 actual bangers. And most of them are bangers. Best of luck to you in the quiz and quizzing at home. Let us have a short commercial break.
All I crave is a good pub feed.
Craig David. Hold That Thought UK Arena Tour. New dates announced for April 2021. coming to an arena near you. Get your tickets now from myticket.co.uk. Craig David, Hold That Thought UK Arena Tour.
Hi, I'm Mick from Supergrass, and we're supporting the Save Our Venues movement to support local music venues during this pandemic. Like many other venues around the country, Bath Moles is being hit by the lockdown pretty hard, so I'm just going to put in a word for donating to their fundraiser to keep them afloat. Address should be down here somewhere. www.crowdfunder.co.uk. Long live Moles. Good luck, fellas.
And welcome back to the Lock-In Pub Quiz. The bane of the first half of the quiz was, of course, the catchphrase round. And I'm afraid we're going to discuss it some more because a quick chat in the break has stumbled us across a couple of Pippa's wrong answers, which I'm frankly furious with myself I didn't ask about before. Pippa, what did you put instead of gingerbread for the picture of ginger spice on some bread?
Split the ginger.
Really fantastic quizzing. Pippa, what did you put for question two, a picture of a cap on a flat?
Cap the rise.
Makes a bit more sense, cap I suppose.
Cap the rise, it makes sense.
Okay.
What about splitting the ginger? What's your justification for that?
Because he was splitting the bread and ginger spice was in there, so it split the ginger. Because gingerbread's not a phrase, it's a thing.
Gingerbread's not a phrase, it's a thing. It's hard to argue with that, although Amy and Ed went along with it like the sycophants they are. Well, Pippa, it's been a real delight hearing about your ginger splitting and your rise capping, but I do hope that you've got at least 7 Jim Carrey movies from the 1990s to tell me about. How do you think you've done on this one?
Probably shamefully bad.
Do you want to take me through them?
I've got The Mask.
The Mask is correct.
Ace Ventura, Pet Detective.
That is correct.
Ace Ventura, Pet Detective 2.
Yes, I believe it's actually called When Nature Calls.
Dumb and Dumber.
Yes.
Brilliant film. Cable Guy.
Yes.
Not creepy at all. Bruce Almighty, which may be turn of the decade.
I think we're turn of the century and decade, I think. Although, if I'm being really pernickety, I think it's at least mid, if not late noughties. But then why are we having this argument? The point is it's not in the 90s list.
No, it's not. Batman Forever.
Batman Forever is correct.
Yes.
Truman Show, although I nearly wrote Ed TV.
Right. Fair enough.
That is correct as well. We're not really letting the others have a look in here, but let's hear your complete guesses.
And then I've got Eternal Sunshine of Spotless Mind, but I'm pretty sure that's the 2000s.
It's another naughty.
I'm out. I'm done.
Ed, we'll start with Ed. Have you got any that you're confident of that Pippa didn't say?
Liar, Liar.
Someone. Yes.
Damn it.
And anything else?
I think this is where I maybe trailed off. Dumb and Dumberer?
No.
No.
And anything else?
The Mask 2. Did they make a second one of those?
Oh, just inventing sequels. It's frankly pathetic to see. Let's move swiftly on to Amy before he says Guy 2.
The only one that I've got that I think might be in it is Man on the Moon.
A Man on the Moon is correct. And the final one, the nichest one, the pointless answer, is a film called Simon Birch.
Oh.
What the hell is Simon Birch? What happened?
I've heard of it, but didn't know he was in it.
Okay, so let us just confirm the scores from the Jim Carrey round. Pippa got 7. Ed, you also got 7?
Correct.
And Amy, what did you get?
I got 9.
9! The lead is extended and in style. So what has that done to the overall scores? It is, well, it's Amy, and then it's Ed, and then it's Pippa, as it has been throughout. Very little social mobility in this quiz. Round 5, however, is the missing lyrics round, which might provide a different flavour. You're going to listen to some terrifying automated robot voices singing popular songs. And you just have to write down not the song or the artist, but the missing lyrics, although often those are actually the song title. So here is your first audio clip.
I'm heading down the Atlanta highway, looking for the love getaway, headed for the love getaway. I got me a car. It's as big as a whale. And we're heading on down to the blank, blank.
Gonna play really? Again?
Yeah, let's have it again. I think that seems only fair.
I'm heading down the Atlanta highway, looking for the love getaway, headed for the love getaway. I got me a car. It's as big as a whale. And we're heading on down to the blank, blank.
Did the repeat listen get you any closer?
Yes.
Oh, terrific.
Well, I don't know if it's right.
Here is your second song.
We get it on most every night when that moon is big and bright. It's a supernatural delight. Everybody's blank, 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 blank.
I am not going to give you that one again, I'm afraid.
No.
I have decided subjectively that that is stone cold, imprinted into all of our minds. Is that unfair, Pippa?
Yeah, it is, but never mind. I listen to Radio 2, Dan.
You what, sorry?
I listen to Radio 2. I'm old.
Right.
That will be on Radio 2.
Yeah, I think I was on the verge of proposing a second play, but actually you've only underlined how well you know this song.
It's on our A-list, this.
You take a big bite out of this massive block of cheese every single morning on Radio 2 and at every wedding you go to.
I work from home. I don't commute anywhere.
Pathetic excuses. Just getting more and more.
I know. I'm pulling them out of the bag.
No one has ever claimed that they didn't get a missing lyric on this pub quiz because they don't commute. Desperate stuff in a pandemic. Right, let's see if this one popped up on any of your commutes. Ed and Amy, it's question 3.
A man walks down the street. He says, why am I short of attention? Got a short little span of attention. And while my nights are so long, where's my wife and family? What if I die here? Who will be my blank, blank?
It's also quite Radio 2. Pippa, do you want it again?
It's so hard.
It is hard when it's the robot voice.
I'd love it again, but no.
Let's have it again.
A man walks down the street. He says, why am I short of attention? Got a short little span of attention. And while my nights are so long, where's my wife and family? What if I die here? Who will be my blank, blank?
It didn't help.
Yeah, I mean, to be fair, this one, I know the song and would recognise the song from the disembodied lyrics, but the actual specific two-word lyric we're looking for, I don't know. Amy's got
it. I recognise them both, but I can't fill those things in, so never mind. It's fine.
No. I'm not very good at lyrics, you know.
Well, I think you should all be able to swing a cat at this one. That's not a clue. It's just terrible improv from my end. Here's question 4.
So I took a big chance at the high school dance with a lady who was ready to play. It wasn't me she was fooling, 'cause she knew what she was doing when she told me how to blank, blank, blank.
I said you should be able to swing a cat at that, but that's because I was looking at the answer. Actually, from the lyric, not really got a clue my end. Let's have number four again.
So I took a big chance at the high school dance with a lady who was ready to play. It wasn't me she was fooling, cause she knew what she was doing when she told me how to blank, blank, blank.
And finally, number five is also not an easy one. It's been a stressful round. Here it is.
And I'm here to remind you of the mess you left when you went away. It's not fair to deny me of the cross I bear that you gave to me. You, blank, blank.
I feel like I was still thinking about number four to focus properly on that one. Is it all right to have it again if other people do?
Oh, of course we'll have it again and it won't help and then we'll move on with our lives. Here it is.
And I'm here to remind you of the mess you left when you went away. It's not fair to deny me of the cross I bear that you gave to me. You, blank, blank.
Yep.
See, or maybe it has worked. It has worked.
The music is now in Amy doing this.
I was honestly just still thinking about three and four. I think you should play number two again for Pippa.
Oh, yeah. Okay. To complete.
Because we've had every other one.
Yeah, I know. You can tune in next week where Amy will be hosting the Lock-In Pub Quiz. And may I say, doing a sterling job. She is more knowledgeable, fairer, and let's not forget, doing all of this on the lash. So here's number two again. Pippa, we all want you to get this so much.
We get it on most every night when that moon is big and bright. It's a supernatural delight. Everybody's blank, 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 blank.
Okay.
If we're all so invested in you getting number two.
I'll get it, guys. It's all right.
Well, before that, we have to have the answer to number one, which was Love Shack by the B-52s. Number two.
I got that right.
Oh. Then the answer to number two is basically irrelevant. But I'll tell you anyway that it was Dancing in the Moonlight.
Yes.
Pippa?
I put Dancing Moonlight.
We all know the song and we all love it.
So I'm gonna add that, right? I forgot the conjunctive words, but everything's fine, right?
I think it's half a point for Dancing Moonlight, but there's a lot of shame attached to that lost half.
Thank you guys for taking pity on me.
Yeah, I hope you're happy, Amy. That pity led us to the words Dancing Moonlight.
I'll take that.
Number three was a lyric from You Can Call Me Al by Paul Simon, but the specific words we were looking for were role model.
Oh, I put lovely friend.
Lovely friend. In the Venn diagram of lovely friends and role models, all of you are in the overlap for me. May I say? The most ham-fisted compliment of all time.
That was lovely.
I appreciate it.
I'll take it.
Number four was Aerosmith and Run DMC with Walk This Way, and the lyrics we were looking for were Walk This Way.
But do the twist.
That's one I actually got.
Gran's ear. Grandma's ear with a sherry.
Pippa, are you sneaking up behind with correct answers while Amy flounders?
No, I just got Walk This Way because we used to listen to it a lot in the old house.
But you didn't sing along to it with the original lyrics of Do the Twist.
No. But I respect Amy for the fact that she's got everything else right, so that's fine.
You could cut the respect with a knife in this quiz.
I've really got all right on this one.
Well, while the cat's away, did the mice put for number five, Ought to Know, off the Alanis Morissette song You Ought to Know?
Yes.
Please.
Ed, we've heard very little from you. Did you get that last one right?
I did, yes. This has been my round, I'll be honest.
How many did you get in total over the course of the round?
Five.
Oh, baby.
Nice one.
That is exactly what you'd hope would happen.
We've got some more of the Paul Simon one.
The arrogance of putting bonus lyrics in parentheses.
Catching up.
Now all my role models have gone. what he says.
Well, he actually says, you're all my lovely friends, and it's been a pleasure quizzing with you. But I've got the long version. Pippa, how many did you get out of five?
3.5.
3.5 is a top score. Well, it's not a top. I'm afraid Ed got the top score of 5, but 3.5 is also a score.
No, I appreciate the pity, though. Thank you.
It's not pity. Has something gone terribly wrong for us in the last couple of minutes, Pippa? Did I cross an invisible line or indeed a visible one at some point?
No. But I did need a replay, so I appreciate that.
Well, I think the replay was entirely fair and I shouldn't have skipped over it the first time. I am at sea. But not as at sea as Amy, who's throwing away her lead with a score of...
3.
That's actually quite good. What a waste.
Compared to Ed.
Well, of course, compared to Ed, who is now still not quite in the lead, but closer. Let's see the total.
Oh, I thought you might be. Oh, I thought that was
But the good news is that the final round, brackets more general knowledge, is also a big one. It is an 8-point round. There is still everything to play for and approximately 5 minutes to play it in. Question one is about Christian denominations, and it is this. John Cadbury, Joseph Fry and Henry Rowntree, founders of what became the UK's Big Three confectioners, all belonged to which Christian denomination? Or to cut out all of that lovely background detail, name a Christian denomination from the olden times. Question two, it's geography. If you traveled in a perfect straight line from Paris to Moscow, how many countries would you have visited? Picture that route in your mind as the crow flies.
Inclusive of Russia and France?
Inclusive of Russia and France. Thank you for clarifying. It's a very... Thanks.
What's the difficulty level on this one, Ivo, do you think?
This one, Amy, is a hard question. But basically, you're just saying a number, aren't
you? It's a guessy bob. Yeah, it's a guessy bob.
Question three. Which Dutch painters, and it's one of the famous ones, paintings Irises and Portrait of Dr. Gachet each have held the record for the most money ever paid for a single painting? Although I don't think either hold the record anymore. Which Dutch painters cost a load of money on two separate occasions over the years? And now question four is a multiple choice. On the 13th of June 1920, the US Postal Service ruled that what may no longer be sent via parcel post? Children, raw eggs, or explosives? Great question.
Really good, that.
Imagine sending any of those by post. Well, as of the 13th of June 1920, you were legally not allowed to in the US anymore.
Who hasn't been tempted to send their children by post? Come on.
It's a little bit of weary parent banter there, Pippa. And as a father of a one-year-old, I will join you in that weary parent banter. The days when I wish I could stick her in a jiffy. But,
straight to the grandparents, jobs are good, and shove some holes in the box, they'll be fine.
Very nice that even within the quite sociopathic riff, you have included a nice destination. Whereas, I'll be honest, I didn't really think beyond the package. I love my daughter very much, and she has lit up my lockdown. But if this was 1919, it'd be a very different story. Or would it, because it might also be raw eggs or explosives. Shit. On we go. Question five. Of the last four states on the Stars and Stripes, brackets the flag of America, were all added in the last century. But what were the last four states that they represented? So what were the four last states to be added to the US of A? Ed, you are so close to overtaking Amy if she obviously stumbles. Do you feel you've done sufficiently well on more general knowledge to do so?
Not necessarily. I think it could go either way. Amy's evidently pretty bright, so she could just pull away here.
This is as nice as YouTube-based pub quizzing gets.
You can do it, Amy.
Yeah, come on, Amy. Say you're literally your rivals. Well, then, with their encouragement ringing in your ears, let's find out if you did win the quiz. I suppose I haven't asked Pippa. Pippa, do you think you might have snuck it in?
Probably not.
Not sure if that is a phrase either. Do you think you might have... I think it's snuck in, isn't it? Not snuck it in.
No, there's no sniper here, I don't think.
Well, let's find out. Number one, Cadbury Fry and Roundtree were all anybody?
Quakers.
If you travelled in a perfect straight line from Paris to Moscow, you would have, including France and Russia, visited 7 countries. Belgium, Luxembourg, Germany, Poland, and Belarus in the middle. The Dutch painter in question 3 was, of course, Vincent van Gogh, or Gogh.
Phew.
The answer to the fun multiple choice about what you weren't allowed to send in the post in the US after June 1920 was, as I slightly hinted, children. Difficult to know whether raw eggs and explosives are still legal sent by post or whether they were banned on a separate occasion, and I haven't done the reading.
You're not allowed to send explosives anymore.
You're not.
I thanked it.
Thank you, Pippa, for confirming that. Those hand deliver your explosives, please, and your children and your raw eggs. Question 5, final question of the quiz, and what a lovely, almost too lovely, almost cloyingly lovely quiz it's been. This is about the new states of the United States. And they are Alaska, Hawaii, Arizona, and New Mexico. Those are the 4 stars on the Stars and Stripes. And you get a point for each of those, cruelly. Amy, how did you do on the American states and indeed the round as a whole?
Really bad on this, on the states especially. I consider myself quite good with the old states. I thought it might be North Dakota and South Dakota and North Carolina and South Carolina.
Well, Amy, you might be good at the old states, but you're certainly not very good at the new states. Come on!
Yes, babe.
Serve it up. I'll knock it down. And apologies if that was actually the joke you meant.
It wasn't, no. I'm too leathered for that sort of joke.
Love that you've been getting leathered. And I'm afraid, what an advert for teetotalism this will be if Ed has won it. Ed, did you do well on this round?
Pretty middling, I think.
Let's start talking in terms of points. Ed, what did you get in points?
I got 3 points total.
And what did you get, Amy?
2 points total.
She snuck it, unless Pippa. What have you got?
I wish I could say I've got 4.
Oh,
because I also did the Dakota and then I changed it to Carolina and I frigging knew Alaska was on that list.
I am sorry. I must confirm that we were talking about point scores for the whole round, not just the US states there with everybody.
No, I am talking about the
Oh, no, I gather I was just checking on the others. Again, yeah.
I put New Mexico as well. Dead mad.
Amy, you've won the pub quiz. We don't need to see any more of your correct answers. Thank you very much. Listen, as adverts for not letting one's head be turned by the vile business of celebrity, this episode has been a glorious success. 3 lovely people getting along handsomely, being forgiving and patient with each other and with my, at times, just cataclysmically bad pub quiz hosting. It is Amy who has won with a pint in her hand.
Well done, Amy.
It is, of course, we're clapping Amy.
Whoa, clap again.
Behaviour. Amy, anyone you'd like to thank?
You, babe.
Ed, a valiant second.
Half a point behind.
A photo finish, but a sort of photo which was taken in slow motion over the course of about an hour because you were always just behind. And Pippa. 3rd place, but with some of the best wrong answers and some of the most unexpectedly right answers you're ever likely to see.
I can only apologise to the entire city of Abertawe. I'm sorry, Swansea. Right. I'm sorry.
The whole city has been apologised for, as is appropriate for the 3rd place contestant. Shame on their hometown. But really no shame for anyone. It's been a delight. Thank you very much for quizzing. If you've enjoyed it at home, well, thank you. And if you've really enjoyed it, would you consider donating to the Save Our Venues Trust, our partner charity? And tune in next week where there will be more Lock-in Pub Quiz action. I've been Ivo Graham and it's been damn hot. Goodbye, everybody.
pub